Today I want to tell you guys something about developing a secure Corona app for 5 million users nowadays, almost 5 million users, with startup deadlines. And especially the secure part and the startup deadline part is the interesting part about the Corona Melder app, the Dutch Corona contact tracing app. But first of all, a little bit of a question to you guys. Did you already install a COVID tracing app or the Corona Melder if you live in the Netherlands? And if you did you get a notification already? Or did you install it and thought, oh, I did get a notification, I deleted it anyway? I think it's good to install the Corona Melder app because it will help stop the spread of the coronavirus. As I just heard from the technical guy of this presentation for the audio check, his friends got notifications, my friends got notifications, and did go to a test, a Corona Melder test, and knew that they were Corona positive. So, a notification by this technical project, so a notification generated by this technical project, has a bigger value than only a notification to create more business value or to create more marketing value. It's a notification that can help save lives, lives of people who didn't get infected with the coronavirus because you stayed inside because you got a notification of a Corona COVID tracing app. A little bit about me. I'm Hidde Skulse. Victoria introduced, worked on the Corona Melder app, but nowadays I'm a chief healthy algorithms at an e-health startup in the Netherlands called Dreampy. I'm full-time working on getting ownership of your own health data as a patient, so getting your data from hospitals, practitioners, etc., etc. So that's my day job, also known as lead developer for the more general title. I was also the technical founder of Visual Radio Assist, still a company where I help radio stations visualize their broadcasts. I'm freelancing at my own company with some other developers who help me. And last year, I was backend developer for the Ministry of Health, Welfare and Sport in the Netherlands. That's a little bit of a strange combination, a Ministry of Health, Welfare and Sport, and backend developer. Like backend developer, you guys know backend developer as a title, but the Ministry of Health and Development is a strange combination I will get into later in this presentation, but it was something that was happening last year. To go to the source of my resume or onboarding with the ministry, I have to go back to October of 2019. I was working on an epidemical simulation project for my bachelor of software engineering. And in that software engineering bachelor, I learned to build a simulation that's simulated infection viruses. So you could create a runner, select a runner, configure that runner with a population size and time that runner has to simulate. And then you got a nice graphical interface where you got total infected, total susceptible, total immune of a population with the help of a factor and like a dial in the simulation where you can drop a Corona app in the simulation. But this was pre-Corona. We didn't know about Corona. It was just like an infection contact tracing app we could plant in the simulation. It was October 2019, and we delivered the project to our lecturer in 2019. And he was really happy with the project, but the RIVM, the Dutch Ministry of getting all the Corona numbers, didn't have that much interest in the app back then. So Henry contacted me again in 2020 when Corona hit the fan, when Corona was a thing in May, and they needed someone who was available with client certificate, really old authentication methods. And I worked at Dreampy for a long time, and I worked in eHealth authenticating practitioners with physical passes, and the Ministry of health, welfare and sport was looking for someone who could build really fast and simple solution for authenticating people via this pass solution for a new app, a totally new Corona app in May 2020. So almost a year ago now. So my resume was this. This was my resume for the ministry, and GitHub open source page where I built an open source UZI card client certificate authentication server in a night. And the next day I was acquired as a backend developer, and I started working on the prestigious Corona Melder project, where I want to talk about today, the Corona Melder project. I think as Victoria introduced really well, you have a lot of contact tracing apps all over the world, and I think they have all something in common, and that is the framework that Google and Apple provide to build contact tracing and to, in the background, check Bluetooth tags with each other. But today I want to zoom in on the Corona Melder and its specificities of this project in the Netherlands, with the ecosystem of the Netherlands. So, when you think about an app and building an app, it's really, really simple for you as a single person, and really simple for a small startup, a couple of people who have a really interesting idea and wanted to realize that and to put it on the market. It's a no-brainer to build the app and search for all the implementations, different ways to build Android and Apple iOS apps, and build a backend with all the technologies you think are the best for that solution. With the Corona Melder, it's a little bit of a different story. The Corona Melder was a really special project for the government, because it had to be built in startup deadline times. As we know, in the Netherlands, we have a tech company who builds apps with deadlines where they plan things in quarters. So if they have a test environment, it must be ready, not in a week, not in 2 weeks, but in 3 months. That's the time, that's the planning schedule type of thing we know in the Netherlands when we're building government apps. So not planning in days or weeks or sprints, but in whole parts of a year. And that was a special thing about Corona Melder. The Corona Melder was a project that was not initiated by the Belastingdienst, the Dutch tax company, but by a couple of people who really wanted to get an app that helped getting the numbers down for Corona infections. So in that crisis situation, I can almost call it, it was really special that the Ministry of Health, Welfare and Sport started looking for talented people in the Netherlands who could build this app, and not talented people in the blue infrastructure of the Netherlands and the tax company infrastructure and the other government infrastructure where IT people build really big projects. No, they started looking into the Twitter world and started tweeting out, hey, we need a couple of people, really smart people, who want to build this app together in a small amount of time. So that was the start of Corona Melder. And that's a really important step in the whole process of developing an app at this scale, this type of deadlines. And where you can change things and change the hiring policy and change the way you start designing an app, start architecting an app. We also did a really, really big change in the way we shared that process with the outside world. It was not so common for governments to share their source, share their really, really detailed source of making decisions. It was never been done before that at a government instance, like the Ministry of Health, Welfare and Sport in the Netherlands, shared something about their source code or their process and planning for implementing privacy by design. And that was, a new baby born, the Ministry Welfare and Sport, the MinVWS repository or GitHub account. It was born in the summer of 2020. The first time where a government instance was sharing all their knowledge, all their processes about developing an app at this size online with everybody. And this was one of the first repos we built, the coordination repo. And it was a repo where we shared the whole process from beginning to end about architecture, accessibility, design. All the designs were made publicly available in Figma. Everybody could comment on them. We accepted requests from the outside community in the Netherlands. And it created, from the start, a really dense community around the app. A dense community that was really critical because the app was not nice to your privacy at first sight. And people wanted to know what is behind that app. I want to know every single line of code, but also every single architectural and governmental decision that is being made for this app. So that's where GitHub was a really special thing in this whole COVID app development. To go back from privacy by design, architecture decisions to more technical, where the app came to life, I zoom a little bit in this repository, this coordination repo, and we could take a look at the backend architecture. So from the whole point of view where we were, almost doing all the projects with Blue Infrastructure, like a Belastingdienst, the tax company, who was also always doing projects in one way, in one big way, where they built really, really big infrastructures for important applications. We started from scratch, but had some requirements. As you see in this picture, we have a little bit of a decoupling between internet distribution and content API. And this distribution and also the distribution of services was a little bit leaded by the way we were hosting this big Dutch CoronaML app, as in the first slide, used by almost 5 million people. And all those people, all those app users, are pulling data from the services. So distribution and content APIs were a really important step in the architecture process of this app. So not only the base where we built the app on was important. So if it was a Blue architecture for the Belastingdienst or another architecture, it was also important to get our content right and make possibilities for caching, like in this distribution layer where we cache all the different kind of keys that are transformed between devices. Also interesting in this architecture and interesting in this architecture compared to other architectures from all the other COVID apps around the world is the introduction of an HSM. So we introduced the HSM to sign all the keys that are transformed between devices and exchange between devices. We signed it with a government certificate structure. So in this right part of the diagram, you see an HSM, and that's a physical device that had to be placed somewhere in a data center and had to be configured by special people to assign those special keys that has to be exchanged between devices and has to be exchanged with our backend. So that was a really important step in the process, but also a hurdle because we had really, really, really tight deadlines for the first demo and for the first acceptance tests. And we had to have an HSM somewhere in place in some data center in the Netherlands. And then we had a party put back, and we had to switch all the data stuff to another data center. So all those small things that had to be related to governance, like the HSM was just a government requirement, had a really big impact on the project because we could not hire some startup specialist or a startup full stack engineer to fix those problems. Those were problems that could only be fixed by the architecture from the government. The firewalls and the decoupling of components is also really visible in this picture. So all the different components of the app, it's a really simple app that exchanges codes, but we have a lot of endpoints that are split up in different services. And in this way, we could scale really, really big. Small flow overview. I think everybody knows the work, the flow of an tracing app. But in short, I want to light up some parts of this diagram. For example, the key server, where the infected key tags are exchanged. And if we zoom in on this diagram with a more interesting crypto node, we see where things are anonymous and pseudo-anonymous. So as I mentioned before, it's really important to know the PKI infrastructure, so the key infrastructure of the whole government, when you're building an app at this size and when you want to sign the app data as a government. So all the texts that are exchanged in this process are signed by the government key infrastructure. So that's a really important thing to keep in mind when you watch take a look at the source code, that the tech infrastructure, so the temporary exchange key sets, are all signed by an PKI overheid certificate, so just a government certificate. And that's like the biggest hurdle we had in the development of the process. We had to have an HSM that made it possible to realize this architecture, where you can be sure that the keys are anonymous and create a relation with external parties. And that's something I really worked on in this process. I worked on the integration of the external port to the GGD portal, and I want to zoom in on that later, but right now I want to zoom in on the pseudo-anonym communication with the GGD portal. Because the GGD portal is an external party, and there has to be some kind of authentication for the app user to the GGD, we had to invent some kind of mechanism where there were like numbers or codes exchanged between the GGD portal and our backend to create a better way of accepting the key sets from the user in the app and make them like infected. So when they are affected in the app, you are notifying indirectly all the other users, you are in contact with. And at that moment, it is really important to take a note that's a really big step in the flow of using the app. So after the GGD portal ticks the green check mark, it has a really big impact on the flow of using the app. So we had to integrate with external processes, and I do not mean like CPU or processors of your computer, but just the processes of caregivers working in a portal and working with a flow that's already really, really, really bushy. They had not any extra minutes per patient, per caller that we could use. So the process had to be integrated really, really strictly. So after a patient get a positive test, we had to be notified of that positive test by the caregiver. But the person at the telephone had the number of his CoronaMelder app on the screen. So the person that was calling in had to look at the screen, say the number to the caregiver or the call center people had to fill in that number in a portal we built, and that portal had to be really minimal. So it had to be really clear what to do in the portal. It's also really clear that there is not that many minutes that they could spend in the portal, because they had not that many minutes to spare. So after the caregiver fills in that number in the portal, the numbers are communicated to our backend via the CoronaMelder app portal you see here in the left right corner. And after the message is back in the Corona app backend, we process that confirmation message, check it with all the different keys and the whole signing key infrastructure, as I mentioned earlier. And then the keys of that patient that is calling in and has a positive test is being stamped as positive in the backend, and the keys are shared with all the other users via the tech protocol. This step is really important, where this step is must be anonymous. So the keys are not connected to a test result, and the keys are not connected to an app instance directly. So the keys are in a database, and after they are in the database, they are not connected anymore to the app account. And after they are marked as positive, or not directly marked as positive, but the badge is marked as positive and pushed to a distribution API. In all those steps, it was not possible to stamp them key for key as positive, because it would introduce a privacy concern. So all those little lines, all those errors, arrows in this diagram, you must keep in mind that the keys are signed with the HSM, which was a big hurdle. And also the privacy by design requirement of this project was a big hurdle when communicating things between different parts of the app. So the Corona Melder app has to be anonymous, the backend has to be anonymous, and the system has to be interconnected with the keys via pseudo-anonym design. A little bit of a deep dive in the app architecture and the things we went through. So I hope I didn't dive too deep and lost you in a way there, but I think it's really interesting to take a look at those diagrams and see which architectural design decisions were made to create a privacy by design app for the Dutch Corona Melder. I want to take a look at the code also, and I want to take a not a look at all the code of the whole project, but first open the GitHub of the different components of the project, and take a look at the different kind of services we built. So you see the first distinguishing first separation between app backend and the frontend portal I was talking about. So the G2G portal is a separate project and a separate service that's hosted in an internet network, and the backend is hosted in a whole other distributed network, where we have a DMZ and the demilitarized zone, and we have a zone where we have a little bit access to the portal and the internet. We have a zone where we only have private access. So all those different components of the app are scattered around in those repositories, and that's one of the four points I want to take a look at the technical side, the development side of this project, like a double authorization with the sandwiching in the portal and backend connection. And I will take a look at the designing infrastructure when designing your software components. So as I just showed in the backend, the backend is decoupled in a lot of components. So all those different directories are all different deployments to an architecture and an infrastructure. So when normally you have one big backend monolith and you deploy it to a lot of different servers, but in this project we were bound to a server where we had access to the HSM for signing keys, and that was a physical HSM, so we had to be in a different data center component. And we had places where we didn't have access to the internet, so the ICC portal, the GGD portal access couldn't be realized. And we had locations where the connection with the internet was possible, but it was not possible to get any other communication in that network. So a lot of infrastructure restrictions where we had to be aware of when developing the app. And a little bit of that infrastructure thinking was also included in the coordination repo I just saw. So when we take a look at the solution architecture, this whole solution architecture, which is also open source, by the way, is designed in a way where all the components are designed to be scattered all over different servers and different infrastructure components. So as a designer and a developer for different startups and a lot of my colleagues at the project were also, it was daily business to build a software component and just deploy it to a server with a standard AWS or Azure deployment scripts. In this process, we had to build the whole deployment chain from beginning to end, all the different steps that had to be taken to deploy it safely. We had to build it ourselves into an architecture we didn't really know. We didn't really knew. So the people from the Blue architecture are called the Blasting Beans, the Text Company, and other architecture suppliers, infrastructure suppliers, were helping us. But it was really interesting to see where the thinking of the building the software had a really big impact of on deploying the software on different services at the Belastingdienst or different services at the infrastructure with other infrastructure companies. And that's this diagram where it comes through. So you have different actions in orange where the different requests had to be made through different firewalls and different public, private, and DMZ. So really, really strange word, demilitarized zones. So all those requests, and you think it's a really simple app where you share your codes and the backend will do some magic stuff with the HSM, and it's all done. The GTD portal is connected, and some anonymization is going on there, but it's all in one big monolith backend. Yes, but the infrastructure deployment is really complex. So getting those things in the right services and the right service where the access to an HSM and the access to the internet is in the right way, it made things a little bit more complex and less startup-y and more like government-like. So as I showed you in the solution architecture, I will scroll through it, but there's a little bit, it's a big part of the process and getting this system of interchanging keys with different mobile phones. Making it work, the biggest part is in the chain is the GTD portal authorization and authorizing the keys that are exchanged between different mobile phones. So that process is complex, as you see here, and had to be designed really rough in the coordination repo. And we had made this public, so people from the open source community did a commentary and made changes to the repo to make this an even better and simpler process for the end user. And the end user had not an extra minute time, so we had to be really precise in coordinating this architecture for the caregiver and the patient. After we confirmed that this will be the design that we would like to build, we built a decoupling between the front end and the back end. So we had a backend repository with all those different projects, and we had another front end repository where we built a portal. And important decision here was which stack we will choose. And as you see here, we are using a .NET Core stack. And as you see here, it's, I think, an Angular stack. I know it's an Angular stack because I made so many hours in this Angular stack. But it's really important to keep those two stacks in mind because we had to make this project in a really short amount of time, but also make the project migratable or make it movable to a more government architecture and a more government type of getting people to work on this project in the future. So in the future, and the more experience in the government has more experience in Angular and .NET Core. So we were restricted from the start to not use all fancy Node.js and other PHP stuff for building backends and nice frontends. Now it was only restricted to building an Angular frontend and building an .NET Core backend just because the restrictions for the future migration. And when you have to make those decisions at start, you can build your whole infrastructure decoupling next then. So the whole decoupling of all the different components and all the different deployments of the backend is happening in the solution, in the .NET Core solution as we speak. So 15 days ago, a new test is made and a new web API is built on top of other components that are now in place in production when you download the CoronaMelder app from the App Store. And I want to dive a little bit deeper in that code. So I have my router open here, and one of the I can show so many interesting parts and so many interesting pieces of this really, really big backend project for a really simple app. But I want to scope it a little bit smaller because we do not have weeks of time, but only like a couple of minutes. I want to zoom in on the authorization. And that's a really interesting thing where the GTD worker would authorize with the system they are already using. It was not possible to use authorization from an external, like client certificates, blue UZI pass system, because it would create a more hurdle for the GTD worker. So we had to design our system, our backend authorization system, around a protocol called the Identity Hub, and a company who is supplying the authorization for the GTD already for a couple of years. So the identity provider from the GTD was then implemented in our backend, which is happening in a nice service called the Identity Hub service. And after we implemented the libraries from the Identity Hub, we had to make it custom because within the communication with the portal and the backend, we could just use the Identity Hub service session. But after that login has happened and the portal is authorized, we had to create an other authorization mechanism because we had to decouple things from the internet and the demilitarized zone. So then we had to build like a sandwich model of authorization where we created an Identity Hub session and then created a new session where we created a standard OAuth to authorization mechanism between services. So it's really interesting to see where, again, a requirement from the client, in this case, the GTD of the Netherlands, is impacting architectural and development processes in a really big way. So the token verification and all the signing or authorization of text that has been exchanged between mobile devices is all happening behind an Identity Hub username password login. But behind that username password login, we are using a OAuth authorization between services, which is really interesting. Example for that is the token verification, where we get a bearer token as input, verify it with the identity server on the side of the GTD, and then say if the bearer token that is used internally is signed correctly with the session from the Identity Hub. So a lot of decoupling there. And then principle and a really good example of creating this kind of service techniques in the backend is the decoupling of the controller, the commandos under it, and the whole decoupling of the request chain. So imagine a backend which has a lot of controllers and a lot of routing, and imagine it working with it with multiple teams and multiple people. At that moment, you have to realize that all the parts of your chain, where it is a confirmation of a tech or a login action, must be decoupled to make it possible to let different people work on it. Because if I say, okay, I will build the authorization for this backend and this authorization sandwich strange protocol, I'm working on it for two weeks and nobody could continue working on the ICC portal because the authorization is blocking all the routing and blocking all the different components of the whole flow of getting a test mobile phone with another test mobile phone to confirm each other, because we had to test that really early in the process to show at the outside world that the protocol between sharing keys between phones with the backend in the middle is working. So in that like really hurdle and in a little time we had, the protocol of decoupling all the components of your whole request chain is a really important one to notice. So for example, the most important action of the backend is the post authorize route. We have an HTTP post to a lab confirmation endpoint. That endpoint is configured in an endpoint name class, which is also really really good advice to use, which with versioning in it, by the way, versioning prefixes. And after we define the route, we give an argument to that route and a comment. So those are just dependency injected with .NET Core dependency injected from the services and from the body of the request. And after this, if I like IntelliJ click on the execute, we go outside the ICC backend project. Just so the GDD backend authorization stuff, we go out of it and we go into a project called components. So I'm running a little bit of an older version of the backend where we put all the components in the component project. But as you see in the latest version of the backend, it is all decoupled in even more projects and decoupled in even more components component projects. So it's really good to notice that we decoupled a whole request chain in a controller on the front project. Then we had a component project where, in this case, the HTTP post authorize comment can be found. We check the arguments with the custom authorization arc validator. That's a really handy way to make classes that just validate the input parameters. So we need a date of symptoms onset, and we need a lab confirmation ID in this request. We could validate that lab confirmation ID in this chain, but not validate like if it's valid, but just validate if the format is valid, if it is a number and like split it by dashes. And we could check if the date is a valid date. And if you go back to the comment, we are executing the action in a writer or another comment. So we are in the second or the third part of the chain right now. And then in this moment, we are really like changing the database. And we're checking the workflow states. We're checking if the lab confirmation ID can be found in database. And if not, we're throwing errors and logging them. And if it can be found, we are making a change to the database, not making a change right away with a direct query, but making a change with a new writer, a new comment. And that's the pull token writer. And if you see where the pull token writer is coming from, it's also dependency injected. So in the constructor of our comment, we are writing this comment writer. So dependency injection is a really important step of doing things in this way. And if we go to the new token writer, we are actually executing the database request. So imagine an Hidde Schultze that just joined the project with his knowledge from a bachelor and some other projects, just seeing the decoupling going on here as a thing like, this costs so many hours of work and so many communication between colleagues. And is it really necessary? And after I worked on the project for like 3 or 4 months, I really enjoy using this way of working because it made it possible to let multiple people work on different components of, for example, the GDD backend, or for example, the key signing components without having to share work, do multiple coding session with multiple people together to just work on one component. Now we can scatter it all over the place and work parallel. And that was a really big strength of the project. So I want to emphasize that. Start with a controller, do your arguments with an argument validator. So your body, your body parameters, your JSON parameters in the body. I'll check the formats with the parameter validator. Then make a lot more components and a lot more comments to just do the actions you need to do. And if we see, we start with HTTP post authorize comment here. We go to a writer comment. This doesn't write to the database. The database writing happens here. So just decouple all your different parts of your request to create a really strengthful way of interacting. And it's also really it's way better scalable at this in this manner, because we can couple all the write actions to the database in this write new token token writer, write new pull token writer, I must say. And that's way we can create transactions to a database instead of like single transactions pulling the database and bunching it, which would have concluded in burning down the whole project after a couple of million users are starting to upload their keys at night or check their keys key sets at night. It was not possible to do dumb stuff in the backend. It must be really scalable and really decoupled to create a strengthful for database transaction. It's in this way. I'm thinking about the stack decisions. I handled them. I think I thought so much that there must be some questions in the way here, and I also saw the chat going on here. Maria, sorry for not zooming in. I didn't saw the chat here. Sorry. I hope you saw the structure.
We have 10 more minutes. I'm wondering if you have some extra slides to show. Otherwise, we can just jump into the Q&A. Because at least I noted down like 5 questions, and I bet that the students have as well.
We are there. It's the Q&A time.
And just because I'm the moderator of the session, I will ask the first question, if I may.
please do. Yeah.
You know, previously I've been working with the government as well, and especially on projects that involved AI and blockchain. And then all the time you talk about blockchain, but not per se about crypto, right? We talk about blockchain as an infrastructure. We always try to convince the government to implement, you know, more and more open source. So can you please tell us how on earth you managed to do that? Like, why in the end the government indeed implemented, you know, open source?
It was really strange. And it had to do with the Ministry of Health, Welfare and Sport don't do any software building at all. So that ministry is outsourcing everything to other organizations within the ministry or within the ministry of the Dutch government, and those other governments are parts of the government are creating software like Dictu is a Dutch government instance. So in that way, we were really software development was really new for the Ministry of Health, and amazing person named Ron Roosendaal starting tweeting out stuff like I have to get a team together and start doing stuff, and that team immediately started sharing all those design decisions and all those user experience decisions with the open source world via an open source Figma file. So that was the first a design decision where in the process everything was shared, like the first screenshots of the app and the first screens. And after that working really well, Hugo de Jonge, like the cool guy from the Ministry of Health in the Netherlands, starting implementing open source in his talks and open source with Ron Rosendaal, to just doing everything open source from the beginning to the end, the coordination process, the design process, and the architectural design process. So it was more of a nature-like process or natural to do it that way than like pinging everybody from we have to do this open source and we are not doing it right now. It was open source from the start, and that was the biggest strength of this project. Yeah.
And I saw one of the questions in the chat asking, how big was your team? Because this sounds like a massive project, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I was really surprised when I joined the team, only seeing stand-ups with the whole team being like 10 people. I was so surprised after going through other government processes where like 5 or 6 teams from 6 or 8 people are per team are working on this kind of science projects. But because Ron Rosendaal or the whole ministry was creating like a talent team where only not the best people, but the best people were working together and just working to one target with all those design decisions in mind and with all those experience years from the best in mind, it was really possible to work in a smaller team. And when we were expanding to another developer or another extra designer, it was really difficult to work with a lot of people on this project because we had to really tight deadlines. So everybody was doing his absolute best, and that was enough to meet those deadlines and meet those the design and development things. So the whole development team was like, I think, 8 people big, not much more than that.
Small, really small, yeah. to admit. And also I think the fact that it was open source, take the ideas from the open source community, right? So in a way, there are only 8 teams on every day, you know, focused on that.
Yeah.
But you outsource ideas from like
most. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Sure.
Can you stop presenting? Because then we can see everybody big.
Oh, everybody's small. Totally forgot about it.
I was wondering if any student would like to unmute themselves and would like to ask a question.
Curious.
Not so many people, not so many. Whoa. Questions. Because otherwise I will ask a question. I see Xing has a question here. Thanks for sharing, Hiram. I received one notification from Corona Melder before. It's very interesting to understand how it is built. One question, how does Corona Melder regularly exchange data with European apps?
Ooh, that's a really, really good question. The European exchange part is also a really complex part because every contact tracing app is doing things in a different way. We all have to build on the the Android and Google framework that is Android and iOS framework that has been created for the contact tracing. So the data is standardized, but the way we exchange data was not standardized in the beginning. So every government was creating an own backend with own design principles from their own infrastructure requirements. So that was one of the biggest hurdles when going European and exchanging with other European countries, like connecting those dots together, connecting those different backends together and let them talk in a format that is standardized again to exchange data. And how regularly they exchange, that's like a little bit complex to go like precisely on so many times a day, but every day there is like an update where all the countries exchange with all the country backends are exchanging with each other. So they have an update on the whole batch of keys of every country, and that's just happening with the delta. So we are not like exchanging gigabytes of key data every time, but it's just with the delta of the data. And every phone is checking like 3 or 4 times a day for a new key set update. And if we as a Dutch backend provide a new key set update with those for example, German keys within it, with Belgian keys in it, then it's possible to get them as a phone and get the notification if in that key set is a key that matches with a key that is has been authorized as infected. So that's a little bit in short amount of time, the explanation of exchanging with other European countries.
Thank you. Now we have here a pool of future software engineers. I'm going to call you like that. It's a fancy word, but this is who you're going to be, guys, in the end, you know, after you graduate. And I truly believe that if we want to have good technology, we need to teach, you know, like the upcoming generation of software engineers about the ethical way of coding. And in your talk, you mentioned privacy by design. Mm-hmm. It's something that I've heard about it like for 5 years now. I think it's pretty new. Could you please clarify to our students, what does privacy by design mean? How do we teach this?
And that's really depends on the level of privacy that by design that you implement. By the start, privacy by design is implicitly like not sharing any user or personal information at all. And in the level we implemented it as a COVID-19 app, it is implemented in a way that we just save and store data that is needed for the core purpose of exchanging keys with different phones, so with the phones around you, and just analyzing that and doing that right at the beginning of the project, not only at the beginning of your architectural and your technical design sessions, but right at the beginning where you build like the first UI ideas out, where you build like how are we phrasing this sentence, or how are we creating this screen in the app for the end user. That is privacy by design, where you're just thinking for every screen you build, every step you build in the backend, every line of code you build and design in the coordination repository of GitHub. You think about privacy by design as a principle where you just store as little as needed for the pure purpose of the app. So we do not save any user information at all, besides the telephone or the mobile phone type, the model number, like if you're using an iPhone, which iOS version, if you're using Android, which Android version, and Huawei, some kind of Huawei version you are using. So that's like the minimal we need. And then later on in the process of expanding the app, we also added a feature where we could pause the app and resume the app of working. And we implemented the feature where we could only get keys on like a Wi-Fi connection instead of all connections on your phone. Those little dials in the app, those little toggles in the app, were like a really, really big privacy concern, just because they implemented storing some user data. So just to let you guys know how big of a thing privacy by design could be if you get it really strictly. Oh, just muted Victoria.
I was saying the team has here a question. If you want to start to get more into app development, which language would you recommend? For instance, Flutter? Where did you start?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a question.
It's not related to the Corona Melder.
not a problem at all, because I think the Corona Melder has one of the best Android developers of the Netherlands working on it last year. Hugo Visser is he called. And if you look at the repository, it's a little bit of a shameless plug for the repositories of GitHub from the Ministry of Health. But if you look at the Android repository, for example, he is using really scalable techniques to build the app. I'm not an app developer myself, just a backend developer in essence. But I will just check check the framework he was using for building the Android app in a moment. Because that's something I really advise you to check out. And one decision that you have to make when you are choosing or getting into app development is, do I have to choose one platform, like going all in on Android or on Swift? Or do I want to go to a company and be like a more full-stack app developer? And if you want a more full-stack developer resume, it's a little bit a waste of time to go all in on Swift and go all in on the iOS side of things, or all in on Android and do the Java kind of stuff. You can better learn something like Flutter to get your resume to a point where you are really, really, really good at Flutter, which is a platform that is excellent nowadays because it's implemented by Google at a lot of services. Or React Native, for example, if you want to build on your front-end web development skills and app development skills at the same time. So make it something make a decision that connects to the personal interests of working in a team that's only focused on one language, or working in teams that are like connected to different kind of app development for different platforms. So which one interests you? That's the question you have to ask yourself.
You know, Roman has here a very interesting question. And actually, looking at the time, I think this is going to be the last question that we will be taking. So Roman asks, in the case if there will be a future pandemic, which I hope it won't, we had enough of this one.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is there a big takeaway from this project? What would be your advice to governments? Hell yeah, give it all.
Yeah, start right away with open source. We made like some kind of script and guide on open sourcing in governments after this project, because it worked so well, and start even earlier than and the design process. I think all the government like more governmental and political decisions could also be open sourced. It's not that. Yeah, that it is a small step for the government, because that's like opening up Valley, but it is like a really big advice to create a better better app development, and in the whole way create a better development a culture with governments, because nowadays government ICT projects are a lot of times like outsourced to big companies who are closer than closed source. And that's not the way we develop apps these days. It must be open sourced. And in this way, we could really reuse components of this pandemic COVID-19 tracing app development process. So we could not reuse the tracing app, but reuse like components, how we build communication with the GTD, for example, or reuse components where we make design decisions at that way. And we could reuse the Figma file for the base UI style of the government COVID-19 app. So those small like reusing of things with open source could really, really help governments creating one, nice culture for creating apps and building things on the internet.
For enhancing mass collaboration, I think, yep. I wish, you know, we would have more implementation of the open source everywhere.
Yep.
And yep. I liked the fact, the way you formulated saying that the governments need to open source even their decisions related yep. to policies or whatsoever, right? Like everybody should be able to contribute to whatever they decide, because in the end of the day they are working for us, no, like the citizens, right?
So we are the clients of the government in more exactly. of the information and software projects either way.
On this note, I want to really thank you, Hida, for taking the time for actually diving into like the code itself. I found it mm-hmm. inspirational. I learned a lot. I hope all our students did the same. And I hope to see you again at CODAM, maybe with another organization. But as always, let's do the last thing of the session. So everybody unmute themselves, and we're going to do some clapping for Hida. Come on, everybody unmute.